Welcome to Shhh, the Talk Show Season 3. If you believe in the conversations we're trying to create here, please subscribe to our channels as that will help us get more reach. If you watch the YouTube pre-roll ads before this episode in completion, that also helps us to make a little bit of money that help us to go a long way. Our show is now available in 3 languages, so you can click on your subtitle of choice, whether it's Sinhala, Tamil or English. You can follow this conversation wherever you are in Sri Lanka. And we also welcome you to continue these taboo conversations with us on our social media, which is Facebook, Instagram and Twitter, and also our blog posts coming out and our articles in the Sunday morning newspaper. Enjoy the show. Welcome to yet another conversation, and we are here today at Papa Rich in Navala. I've heard a lot of good things about this place, so I'm looking forward to experiencing Papa Rich. So thank you to Papa Rich for letting us have the place. This famous thing of Kalunang Katai in this country and this part of the world, especially South Asia, we have this humongous issue with the fact that our children might be born dark, because God forbid if they are born dark-skinned, who's gonna marry them, and a number of like different social issues that we attach to God-given melanin. So I wanted to talk about it today, and that's the topic of colorism. I know that it's been an issue since the day I was a kid. I've been so conscious of it in school and all that, this whole kalui sudui, this thing that you hear from teachers or wherever you go also, okay, yeah, I have fairer skin tone, right, than average in Sri Lanka. And then this whole value that people sometimes attach to me, I get annoyed sometimes, you know, like, sudui ne e hinda hondai, like, WTF, right? I have two beautiful ladies, Kalpanee and Devni. Thank you so much for coming here. Yeah. Everybody's seen you out there. You're like this Sri Lanka supermodel in high demand, and you know, like
Campbell of Sri Lanka.
The Naomi Campbell.
Maybe we need to talk about
yeah.
In terms of culture.
But this thing of where you've been such a huge voice also, as well as you've taken down publicly a couple of big global brands when they talk about this whole superficiality about attaching color to somebody's worth and beauty. You represent an industry that is built on beauty standards. And then you've been such a huge voice on social media as well. I've seen your posts and stuff like that, and you're like, you're so badass, right?
Yeah.
you're like, This is me, and you like deal with it, and this is who we are, and I love that. Have you ever had to deal with this?
Have you ever not is the question, I think. For me, like at least at school, especially at school, like kids can be little, but especially at school, I think my melanin was my defining factor. Like everything else aside, I was too brown to be brown is what, like how, you know, like it's like you're too brown to be brown. Like growing up in school, like in Colombo, it's hard. Like mostly from a South Asian, I don't understand the obsession, but people used to call me crow, which was really like, but because of the person that I still am, I was like, oh, it doesn't matter, I don't care. And I let it, like I made it so acceptable that even my best friends started calling me black. Like my nickname at school, there were two Devnis, so my nickname at school was black. So across the board, from best friends, now they don't, like I'm like not anymore, but best friends, people I don't like, anyone would just be like, hey, black. And I would respond. That was...
And people are completely insensitized to the fact that this is not okay.
Yeah, right? But in some people's defense, I completely owned it, at least. Like, I was like, oh, yeah, you know what? Fair enough. Like, you know, okay, sure.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want to be called crow. I didn't want all the jokes that came with it. Because it really, really sucked. Because you couldn't really change it. It was something that no matter what you did, I saw it as a bad thing, but I couldn't change it. So if I can't change this inherently bad thing about me, then I might as well own it and then just deal with it.
But as a child, I was made consciously aware of the fact that I was fair. It was like the only thing that everybody used to say, like, Ane sudu baba, sudu baba. You know, every auntie you meet, every person on the street. So you become so keenly aware.
So keenly aware.
As a child, when you're... Does it affect you or does it become like, oh, this is normal?
I think because, like, my dad's side is Berger and, like, most of my family is really fair. So there was that, like, juxtaposition as well. And my mom, my maternal grandma, she's quite dark. And it was always like, oh, Archie again. Like, you know, she's dark because of Archie. And then my other siblings were quite fair, never got that. So even if we used to go for dinner and, like, you know, those calypsos used to come, they'd play like Kalu Kelle and then everyone would just be staring at me. And I'd be like 6 years old, like, which hole do I want to crawl into? Okay. And like, even if someone complimented me, would always be like, oh, you're so nice for a dark girl. Or, oh, Kalu not Lassanai. Or Dakum Kalu, yeah, which yeah. were the most backhanded, like, are they even
the backhanded compliments?
Just like, it's like.
That must happen a lot in the industry as well, right?
I had a very different experience though. Okay. Because one, mid-tone, right? Mm. Because like it needs to be spoken about, because when you talk about, you know, whether you're brown is an entire spectrum. If you're on the side of fair or, you know, yeah. the side of being deeper toned, not each person or body or individual has the same kind of experience, right? For me, the time I started noticing it was when my brother was born, and he was markedly fair. And I was 3 years old. It wasn't my parents. It was more along the lines of what other people would say. Mm. Because like you said, it was such a huge thing on him being like, Sudui Lassanai, Malihari Lassanai. And I was acutely aware that I was never that, you know. And one person, you know, was trying to teach me color and, you know, would do the whole hand thing like, Sudui, Sudui. Mm. Like, it wasn't like your... dark, but it was more like Mali is so fair, you know, it was a marked characteristic. And then it became this sort of weird thing which I got sensitized to, or desensitized, I guess, but like I was sensitized, I think, to a certain extent, to the fact that this happens in society. And I was aware that this was a bias, because I knew, I think, you know, this whole Tambapani Talelu was there, right? And then, you know, this whole exoticization or like you looked like the ideal was also being said.
In Sri Lanka?
In Sri Lanka, okay. In Sri Lanka, like in different ideas, like in the sense like where you say, oh, you know, like it's neither good nor bad. It's
but it's like Kuveni was dark, right?
That's the thing. But then you say Tambapani and Talelu, like, you know, the color of mid-tone, okay. And then I fall into the mid-tone category all of a sudden, yeah. Right? So that's what I'm saying, like my experience was like varied, and then as I said, there was always this some reason, oh, it must be like akka sports karna other, like there has to be a reason that she's darker, yeah. She simply cannot truly be this color, like yeah. Underneath she must be fair, right? And they'll be like, oh, Scott Dekina and this and that, you know, so clearly underneath she's fat, right? I wouldn't say it didn't affect me, but I think I disassociated.
Yeah.
Because also physically, I was, you know, like our school uniforms, right? They're like bags over you. And I was, you know, very much on the narrow side, you know, of the spectrum. And, you know, femininity, all of this was like, away from me. So beauty wasn't something that I connected with. I completely went the other way. I was just like, okay, fine, I'm good at my academics, I'm good at studying. That's my identity. That was what I built. So no one messed with me because I was, you know, I guess like in the sense that by no one I mean, even like if it's boys, they say mean things. It affected me up until maybe about 12. Mm. Afterwards, I couldn't care because it was not.
How about you? Marriage. Because teenage girls are become so conscious about what we look like, what our bodies are shaped like. We're trying to sort of fit in with the crowd. We're trying to meet some sort of ideal.
I think what you were talking about, I really resonated with that whole idea of I disassociated from it. Like, I really focused on like academics. Beauty was never something I thought I was worthy of, ever. And that's why so much of, I think, who I am today is like, that's not okay.
Sorry, beauty was never something you thought you were worthy of.
That's something that when I unpacked it, I remember this very clearly. I was sitting in a gender studies class at uni, in a black feminism class, and then he's just talking about these things, and the next thing I know, I'm sobbing in a lecture, look like a loser, but I was in tears because for the first time in an academic setting, I was getting the language to articulate what I was feeling. I had never, like, I think even explaining to my mom, my siblings, it was a joke. It was like, oh, just brush it off, you know, you're fine, like, you know, it's not a big deal. And that's the other issue. It's not seen as a big deal, but we don't see how pervasive it is, how it goes through economic, social, jobs, marriages.
But society does make it a big deal.
But if you get affected by it, you're supposed to suck it up and, you know, go put some fair and lovely, don't go in the sun, you know, you're pretty, just don't complain. And it's so sad that I had to separate like my physical appearance from my worthiness. That like I couldn't, you know, have good academics, I couldn't do things, and I couldn't also feel like worthy in my own skin. And I think like I left like school, I left Sri Lanka and I was 16, and I got a scholarship abroad and I moved abroad by myself at 16 for my last year of school. And there I was in Melbourne, and having people come up to me and be like, oh my god, I love your skin. Again, like, the exotic aspect to it, which is also problematic, but, and there's been moments where I'm like, that's not okay. But like having that, I think that's the first time I ever felt like, Oh, okay, this is not something that I have to hide away from the sun, hide away, wear lighter colored clothes to not look darker. When I came back to Sri Lanka the first time, my parents were just like rocking up with black lipstick, black clothes, just like, I want to unpack this and I'm going to do it through my life.
Yeah.
Like one thing that really, I think, looking back was so problematic was we were on a family holiday once. We were on a Sri Lankan Airlines flight. And I was with my siblings, they're triplets. So it's three of them, my parents, and I was there. And the air hostess comes up to me and assumes that I was the maid, like I was the nanny. And that's that intersectional aspect as well.
Yeah.
Like, how much do we equate dark skin with, like, you know?
Now, I wanted to talk about that actually, because even when the crew and I, we were discussing this before the episode also, this thing about it, it's not just in Sri Lanka, it's in a lot of South Asia where you associate class or social status by the color of your skin.
Yeah.
Because I don't know where that idea comes from. In India, for instance, you know, the darker you are, the lower the class. I guess it's because a lot of field laborers staying out in the sun, the skin darkens more. And so you associate that kind of lifestyle or that kind of working class with the color. But yeah, this thing of, I mean,
it's like good old colonization as well.
Yeah, is it colonization, you think?
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think that if we took away colonization and we removed it from our minds, I still think that we would, that colorism would still exist in our society.
Because
I think it's so ingrained with like a system of supremacy that comes with it, where, you know, I had a friend in school once and it stuck with me. Or, Dev, if you were fairer, you'd be so much prettier. Or like any fair girl is pretty, or like just that kind of really tacit undertones of, it's so tacit sometimes, so tacit, even in school, even like, you know, the whole Sudhuputta thing, like why is it only Sudhuputta? Why are we putting names in front of the putta? Can't the putta just be? It goes like, it's so deep.
But you kind of emerged into the modeling industry when you were overseas, right? In the UK.
So
for you, it's like the skin tone was what, do you think the skin tone was what marketed you more or made you more marketable?
Even like, you know, if I show like my childhood pictures with my brother, and especially, you know, when you're younger, your melanin isn't developed. So my brother was even fairer and I was a kid running around, right? So I was tanned. Comparatively, but I was still, you know, I was still identify as, you know, someone with color, you know, melanin, right? But this joke, or like, you know, people will say, you look like your, you know, brother's like playmate, like, you know, who was like, you know, from a different social class, you know, like these things are, you know, that the only reason I was shielded from it was privilege. In the sense of whether it's social class whether it's intellectual, you know, privileges, because these things also compound in the sense of, not that I believe in IQ, in the fact that when you have certain access to certain things, you can read up. You know, I had a computer, I was, you know, exposed to more media than the average, you know, experience in Sri Lanka. And I went abroad early as well. I went at 17. All of these things sort of build into experience. And like growing up at 17 in England is very different to growing up here in Sri Lanka at 17. You're about that brink where your confidence is like make or break. And just like what she was saying, it was like, for the first time I heard in my life, like, you're beautiful. Mm-hmm. Or like, you look like this person. And like, even with like, let's say Naomi, it's that question of like, I'm not of her ethnicity. I do not look like her. However, people see that. And why do you see that, right? It's racism as well, right? Because even though if it's a compliment, again, I won't say it's over, because people aren't saying that to be malicious. It's like ingrained bias. And when we were speaking about whether colonization has to do with it, yes, it is a colonial hangover. Mm. But like what she said, even if we remove it, how far back do we go? And she's been in my sessions, and you might know, we do unpacking sessions, right? So like, we've had this conversation with like multiple women, in like mostly women, yeah, I would say, in close circles. And we've gone way far back. You know, you take something like religion. You know, pau kala tiyennone for you to be of a certain skin color. Pin karahama tamai, like pin manta paata is, to be fair, e haamduro hari pin manta paata. And to be also to be fuller bodied. You know, when you're thinner, like I was always with my features, you know, larger than the average, lips, curly, like, you know, I have curly hair, and my features, my tone, all of this, they came together along with my physical appearance, my structure, where, you know, things like starving Ethiopian to African to, you know, Muru from Nigeria, from our books, the whole gamut, you know, has been said to me. And again, not from my peers, because again, privilege, which compounded, because they were aware. They never made me feel, you know, unworthy. But no matter how much privilege you have, society makes you feel unworthy to the point you like completely.
Yeah. I've grown up wishing I could be darker, simply because it gets way too much attention for my comfort, you know. And that is also a kind of an insecurity, not that I'm even trying to sort of compare how it feels, but this thing of, because you're inviting certain maybe negative experiences in your life, because people attach some sort of value to what you are, the color of your skin. So it just feels easier to look like everyone else, right? And then when you take Sri Lanka, like melanin, the whole issue with melanin, like you mentioned, like the fairness creams that mothers are trying to get daughters to put them on, brides, when somebody loves them for who they are and is ready to marry them, they're going and trying to change their skin tone to that association of make me look more worthy or make me look more valuable. And then, you know, this thing about marriage proposals, if you look at the way marriage proposals in this country are written, right, looking for a fair, pretty girl, like what the hell, right? What is that all about? Like, and men also trying to be, you know, fairer or whatever. I can't understand why in a country where you're surrounded by brown and this melanin is to scientifically protect us from the weather, to ensure our human survival in this part of the world, to protect our bodies from UV rays, you know, the more melanized you are in this, in the closer you are to the equator. When we know that this is who we are and this is our sense of identity, and this is also a country that goes on about Sri Lankan and all of that, why do we want to then look like someone else that we're not?
I think that Sri Lankan identity is such a pigeonholer. It's such a specific type of identity. Like, yeah. As a tall, dark, plus size, outspoken, short-haired woman, I'm like the anti-proposal. Like, I am literally the opposite of it. And I've had people well-meaningly always kind of like slightly joke about it. Like, oh, you're getting too educated. Or, and there's so many tools, there's so many not enoughs, there's nothing where you're just okay as people are. And I think, like Kalpanee mentioned, there's this whole element of privilege. Like, we can have these conversations. But for some people, like, their entire identity is interwoven around it, but they don't have the means to actually understand that it's not a reflection of who they are, or that they don't need to spend their entire life, like, in a circle of self-loathe because of the fact that they're just brown. Like, I find it slightly funny how we're obsessed with this idea of darkness. It's like social currency, moral currency.
But at the same time, we're also obsessed with our sense of identity.
Yeah.
Right? We're so proud to be Sri Lankan. Mm. But then you don't want to look like a Sri Lankan. You want to identify yourself.
It's getting better now. But look at like billboards, like tourism ads, all that kind of stuff. Yeah. Like, it's the village kids that are running around dark. And then you come to Colombo, the beaches, and it's like, you know, a girl with a cocktail. And it's like,
I want to talk about that because you're from this world, right? So,
the fact of
the modeling industry. I'm talking about the modeling industry, right? Commercial modeling, right? And I've belonged to the commercial industry in advertising. And this age-old thing when we talk to clients, when brands want to advertise, you're looking for, if it's a baby product, you're looking for the sudu, baba. It's got to be a fair child. If it's a child's product, if it's a food product, you're looking for fair models. If it's a beauty product, if it's a fashion product, you're looking for fair models. They want to see fair, fair, fair. And it's like, who are you selling this to, right? So in the industry, in the Sri Lankan industry, now in the UK industry, yes, you might be exoticized. But in the Sri Lankan industry, how has it been? Like, do you find yourself, or did you find yourself before you became Kalpanee, did you find yourself being pitted against fairer models, having to sort of work much harder to get the jobs?
Absolutely. To be honest, one part of modeling was, I think, that healing journey. Because as I said, I disassociated. It was my way of growing into femininity. However, when I entered the industry, I realized how discriminate, in the sense, like, you know, what a rampant bias existed, like what you said. And I did only two shows, and that was like SDF, which is now Mercedes-Benz Fashion Week, and Colombo Fashion Week. No shoots, no nothing. I would go for castings and it would be like, why don't you color your hair? Or, you know, the context to the why don't you try this cream, this facial, come to our salon, do this, rebond your hair.
Hair only, because I know a lot of models who actually go and bleach their skins. Absolutely, because it's almost like expected. And a lot of the younger models and all that trying to get into the industry are doing this.
Yeah.
Because
absolutely, 100%. And the only thing that shielded me again was privilege, because an ego. Because I could be like, oh, this is still an infant industry. If I was in my head, which is also wrong, because I was like, if I was good enough for England, I'm fine for here. This was 10 years ago, Kalpanee, not, you know.
And do you think, like, because Kalpanee had experience in England, therefore she was more acceptable here?
It was Naomi Campbell, not me. Because it wasn't a matter of my experience in England, because it didn't apply here. It was a whole other style of modeling. I didn't know how to catwalk. We would walk straight. It was in two different sort of aesthetics. And I just had to appear. I didn't develop my modeling skills there because there was no challenge. I was just put in for the diversity factor or whatever it was. You know, like, you're in the mall. It's not like you're, you know, helming major, you know, brands. It's not like your face of a brand. So you need, it's like any profession, you need to have that experience to learn, right? And, you know, I never learned. So I wouldn't say I even entered the industry here with any experience. But for, as I said, there's shielding, which again comes from privilege, because I could again be like, it's okay. It has nothing to do with me. It has something to do with you. I am not unworthy, or that's what I thought, right? And I was like, I'm fine. But then, when you get on to like the larger brands, it becomes more and more pervasive.
Yeah.
Because the niche I was operating in, at the very least, or the niche I found a footing in, was different. The Colombo sort of editorial up end, because again, like there's...
So they were looking for the more exotic skin tone.
Yeah.
You've had modeling experience, you mentioned. Yeah. And
like, I think when I was in Melbourne, I had a few people approach me, and every time it was a big solid no, because I didn't really see... I don't know, I was nervous. I was a bit, you know, like, I don't want to do this yet. I think social media, that kind of stuff was enough for me at that point, because I think, like, I think you mentioned it, I think the whole unpacking it, healing through it. But then, like, in Sri Lanka, I was like, you know what? I'm going to stop my own self-limitations that I put on me, and I'm going to go do it. But I think, like, the couple of times I've been approached, it's always been in the body positivity, dark girl angle, which is amazing. Like, it's good. Like, we're actually acknowledging, you know, we have different body types, we have different skin tones. But it's slightly, or more so than slightly demeaning to be only that. But even with, like, in Melbourne, something that really stuck with me was this photographer person. I don't even know. It was a very weird experience. But he was talking to me and he's like, oh, you're really pretty, blah, blah, blah. But you're probably the darkest I'd go. Which to me, I was like, I honestly was like, wait, what? And then he repeated it. And I was like, I just looked at him and I honestly was just like, does he have like a Dulux paint wheel that he like rocks up and measures? And like, what do you mean the darkest I'd go? People aren't like colors on a spectrum. They're full human beings that have so much to offer beyond skin tone, regardless of whether your industry is an aesthetics based one. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And even if I go to salons here, every time you go, I know it's well-meaning. Again, I try to empathize with the fact that they're trying to, you know, be kind, or they're trying to be good to me, try to be offer a good service, or probably that's what people come and ask. But every time I even go on for a wax, it's like, put baking soda and lemon to make your darkness go away.
Mm.
And I've done it. I've done it growing up. I've sat there, like, scrubbing at my skin, hoping that, you know, I'll become like my siblings or whatever. But now I'm just like, okay, it's not even worth my time. I might sometimes engage and say why, but I don't want to make them feel uncomfortable, because, again,
it's curious because having worked in advertising and having worked in brands that insisted on this white supremacy, this fairness value, is society conditioning this value, or are advertisers and the commercial world or media conditioning society? Where are we going wrong? In Sri Lanka, it's important to understand. Media creates things to get the ratings, right? So they give what people want. On the other hand, people are also influenced by what they see on media. And I've seen the way media, for instance, reports on darker skinned women. Recently I read like there's this girl who's won some beauty pageant in Russia, right? And where in Sri Lanka she had a big challenge in sort of being recognized or whatever, and then she's won this queen something in Russia, and the Sinhala paper that ran the article, the headlines were like Kalu Kella, you know, and it was like almost surprised that this Kalu Kella had won something, a beauty pageant. And I've seen that time and time again, the way media talks about women, it's like even if it's a woman who has died, say she's got hit by a train, the way you're describing her is like that Sudhu Lassana Kantavak, or they say Kalu Kella, Kalu Kantava, Kalu Manusya. This skin tone is a big descriptor.
So it's a matter of whether the chicken or the egg came first, right? And if you look at articles, there's a giant conglomerate which is very proud of serving people, doing good by, you know, making money by doing good and doing better, etc. And that company, if you look at I want to say, like, maybe go and check out like Economic Times of India, and on how they created a rural market for a fairness cream, is so morally unethical because they go and they don't identify themselves as so and so. They create this character who has gotten a scholarship and suddenly, like, you know, gotten placed elsewhere. She's doing well. And
gotten
you,
a job.
Yeah, and you're bringing these people in and then you're introducing them to this character. And then being like, she got it because she started using this product. And they're so proud of it. And it's still up, right? And whether it's a name change or whatever it is, they are now responding to the market. But did they create the market? They absolutely did. Did they sustain it? Yes. Because again, it's that intersection between like what exists in society and what capitalism does, what the patriarchy does. What makes money? These are all, you know, a system can't stand up on one pillar. There are multiple pillars holding this situation, I want to say, I guess, up. And you can't take one pillar down and expect it to go down. There's no leaning because there's something else propping it up, continuing it on. Society benefits from it. Like what you said, there's a social currency attached to it. There's social mobility when you're of a certain color. And earlier you asked me of like, even to this day of like modeling, right? Even to this day, I cannot demand the amount of money that a counterpart for the same job of the same skill level would get for a fairer tone. Like I've seen screenshots where, you know, because obviously there's young people, younger people, younger to me, are more exposed to different kinds of media and they're more in touch with globalization and what you call trends, which I think are harmful to begin with. But even on a trend, let's say, of like diversity, tick box, or like brown skin, melanin popping, tick box, whatever it is, even when they try to get me in, the seniors would be like, how much is she asking for? And then it'll be like, oh, well, if you're like, if you're going to pay that much for her, might as well get a foreign model or might as well get XYZ for the same price because I am not worth it. I'm not worth that money. And I've also been, you know, again with this particular conglomerate, where once I was dropped like 35 to 40 minutes before the show, after 3 months of fitting for a huge campaign unveiling, and it wasn't my tone. It is that intersection of like, I was, because I kept asking for a reason as to how they let me go. I wasn't notified it, you know, following the appropriate channels. It was just that the director saw me, didn't like me, decided to get rid of me 40 minutes beforehand, right? All of these things like come together. It's your features, because you can be brown, but you can't be of that brownness.
But when it comes to social media, right? So now, on a commercial media front, on a mass media front, you have brands that make that work. But social media, it's not the brands; it's the people. It's society that is creating certain ideas and stuff, right?
I think social media gave me a space to to claim the space that I didn't ever get. Like, it gave me a platform, it gave me space to just be myself, unpack, feel whatever I wanted to feel, kind of be open and honest. Things that I didn't get, because I think growing up, there was such an element of this is who you are and this is what you do. But I was like, you know what, no, I'm going to take that and see what else I can be. And social media is a great tool for that, because it's your platform, right? It's yours. This is my space. If you don't want to come, you go.
Social media is cruel. Oh my God. Right? People just don't. There's absolutely no filtering there, right? Oh my God. Have you had to deal with that?
Oh my God. I've had people message me and be like, you're not even that pretty. I'm like, okay, like, cool.
Just random strangers.
Randomly. Oh, I've had people be like, you know, like, even if I'm talking about like, you know, male validation and stuff, they're like, I don't even want to get with you anyway. And I'm like, okay, if I wanted to be disappointed, I'd exist in the patriarchy a bit more. Like, I don't want to date you either. Like, what do you
mean?
But
is this associated with your skin
tone? Absolutely. Absolutely. It's like, Kalui or Katai or Kalui, Katai. They're so synonymous. Like, just the way that we even, like, even the whole, like, dialect, those things are so synonymous. And men especially weaponize it a bit as well. I'm not saying men aren't affected by it, 100%. But like even at school, the same, all the same people that one person that really bullied me, because I was still like kind of a popular person, but I was still bullied, turned around a couple of years later and asked me out, and I was like, no. But it's so interesting to think of how men use this beauty ideals against women as well to kind of push you down into subservience, even in like marriages or whatever. Like the whole like, oh, you know, I married you, you're dark, you know, that whole thing. Yeah. And even like, I see my grandmother and the way she's operated in the world from an older generation. She's like 80 now. And seeing the way she operated, like there's this element of, you know, inferiority, therefore I have to make up for it in so
that
many other
lesser
ways. Lesser. And the other ways included subservience, increased obedience, more or less rebellion, because you're already starting off at a lower pedestal. And like, I don't know, I think that's why I'm so vocal on social media, because I think growing up I was surrounded by that kind of thing, and I don't want to even accidentally keep going. And for me, social media is a bit like a journal. It's where I unpack things, and I unpack things with like this, like other people that sometimes resonate what I'm saying.
I think it's a little I love when women are owning who they are and being authentic on social media, but then I also think it's sad that social media, being a platform where we can really help empower that sentiment with women and men, where social media also in a way still caters to the, especially when you're talking about colorism, you get filters that make you fairer, and you get so many Sri Lankan girls and boys using it. And I'm like, huh, why? Like 3 steps forward, 10 steps backwards. Like why are we so, why do these filters even exist? You know?
Money, capitalism. Yeah. Again, it's for me, when you look at it, I don't look at the individual. I've learned to look beyond it. And again, as I said, that's privilege and either sensitization or desensitization, because I no longer speak of it or experience it in the way she does, because I've moved past that stage, I would say, because I am older than you, and also being in the industry, in modeling, you sort of get put in under like a microscope. I had depression before, but when you've had it, you're more susceptible to it. So that's why I say, like, you know, a lot of people come to, you know, because I coach as well, and even at the agency, modeling is not a space for you to reclaim it, because you can be like, okay, I'm in my individual space, but you're not, right? The moment you open up your social media, or the moment you go out into the industry is horrendous, like you said, you know, unless you're working with like known brands and, you know, friendly faces, if you're in the industry, it's cruel. It's going to put everything back at you from society and make it thousandfold. People break, your self-worth is like entirely gone, right? I mean, this is not a secret. People develop eating disorders to, like what you said, you know, models who change their skin color, hair color.
And let's talk about how dangerous that is, because these girls, especially you see models doing it, and models are looked at as the influencers of what beauty standards are. And then models openly talking about, you know, these skin treatments that they go for. They use their social media platforms and show themselves getting injected by these bleaching nonsense and all that. You get young girls and mothers who think, ah, there's a solution to make my daughter fairer, sending them for these treatments. These things create cancers, skin cancers. These things create internal issues, you know?
Yeah. The irony is that, this formula is, I don't know if you're allowed to say it, but either way, this formula is used in cancer patients, ironically, the chemical, because it does give you, you know, the ability to fight like free radicals, etc. The issue is not the chemical compound per se, it's because Sri Lanka doesn't separate it as a medical treatment or a medical intervention, so it's not regulated under health, it goes under food, and we don't know what's in these formulas. So it can have mercury in addition to the compound that's being marketed. So yeah, That's what I'm saying. Like, you know, we don't know whether all those formulas are, you know, cancer-causing or even illegal to begin with.
But anything that you dig around your natural self with, you're doing something artificial on yourself.
But then
you're
how
probably
far do you
endangering
go?
Yourself,
I
right?
mean, you know, makeup. To, yeah. you know, colouring your hair, to wearing certain clothes. I mean, synthetic clothes, I'm very susceptible to it because, you know, I have lupus and autoimmune conditions. So everything we eat, you know, none of it is natural. Our existence is not natural. And then, you know, we are going into like this whole pitfall of what is natural. You know, if you are saying that, you know, you're allowed to express yourself in whatever way you want, you can be whoever you want. I'm not equating skin color to your identity or your orientation or anything of the sort. But what I'm saying is, there's no such thing as, you know,
natural
anymore.
Okay.
You know, and at the same time, I would say, like, if you want to be blue, go ahead and be blue, you know, if that makes you happy, right?
I get what you're saying. Yeah. I respect that.
Problem
I respect
is
that.
That.
But why do you need to be unhappy as who you are? Is the question that I would keep asking Sri Lanka.
Like, it's a privilege, no? To be satisfied with who you are. And in the place where you're at, it's an absolute privilege. Or you have to fight to carve out the space. And like what she was saying, I'm not saying, when I want to finish that part to say that I'm not over it. When I said I moved past it, I got exhausted by it. Absolutely exhausted, drained. Because like what she said, I was in the stage of having to fight to exist. And then I developed, you know, because with experience you develop a sort of, again, it's not
thick skin, pardon the pun.
Yeah, but that's what I was saying. I don't know if I'm desensitized or sensitized to this fact. Because I no longer talk of it as if something that affects it, like as if it's something that affects me, because my income no longer depends on it. My existence, my validation no longer depends on it, because there were, again, other structures of either the patriarchy or the capitalist system that helped me insulate myself from it and then use my privilege to speak on it, right? It's an absolute privilege to be like, none of these things matter. And even when we come back to the social mobility, why are parents doing it? Why are people saying this? Like what she said, people are just trying to help you sometimes. Yes, there are assholes, if you can say it. I mean, there are terrible people.
I don't know, maybe,
there are cruel people.
I can't be as understanding as you are, and like, I guess you come from a much higher wisdom, but I just can't understand why people would be assholes on what someone
wisdom.
Looks like.
Enlightened company.
Experience. But
I get it. I get what you're saying. I just have difficulty.
Yeah.
Allow that sort of if I see, because I have a lot of friends who have darker skin tones, and I don't even think about their darker skin tones until we are in sort of company where it's brought up, and then I'm like,
it's like you understand that society is a certain way, they're conditioned in a certain way, and then you're like, you know, you're not being, it's not your wisdom per se, you're being like, I am putting worth into myself regardless of what you say. And that ability to go on that self journey, not everyone has. Because if you are waiting on a marriage for economic prosperity, you're dependent on it. I'm just gonna hand it over to
that's
her.
That's okay. I think when, like, while you were talking, the only thing that was running in my head was that, like, I know you don't notice it in your dark friends, but some of your dark friends, the only thing that they can sometimes think of, like, it's such a big reflection of their self-identity.
No, I get it.
And again, with, like, makeup.
I guess I'm just angry because society has created
I'm so
that environment.
Angry, but I think I've moved past the angry black lipstick rebellion that I had, that face of, like, the side shave and everything, to a more, like, okay, why is this? And I think it also comes down to pretty privilege. Like, pretty privilege is 100% a thing. Doesn't matter on your skin tone sometimes. It exists across all social strata, jobs, whatever. There were studies where in America, jurors would give higher sentences to darker skin African American women than lighter skin African American women. Again, so moral currency, that whole thing. But like, I don't know, like, I think the issue here is that, like, if it's going to positively benefit you, if it's going to solve a lot of your problems, then I think people should have that free choice. But the problem is the way it's marketed, the way we lie to society, young girls, people, young boys, and say, you're ugly, you're not worthy, so you have to change. That's the problem. If I wanted to go dye my hair blue, that I don't not dye my hair blue because I think my black hair is unworthy. But I would be getting, I would be bleaching my skin because I think my dark skin is unworthy. And I think that messaging needs to change. And even with filters, you put on a filter, it's all Eurocentric. You get blue eyes, you get a thin nose, you know, it's like, oh my God, anyways.
Yeah.
It's gonna.
Yeah.
In the sense of, now let's say when we develop film and when we develop color, the first reels was not calibrated to brown skin. The time they started calibrating to brown tones was because furniture manufacturers said, you can't see the difference between our mahogany and this. That's when they started changing it. It wasn't a people-based approach. It was, again, marketing that fused. Even in Sri Lanka, like, you know, or anywhere, like, where we didn't have the proper makeup that would match our faces, right? So thus, you would have all of these actors and actresses with a fairer tone simply because the product didn't exist. And then, you know, all of these things overlap and like perpetuate. You have photographers and videographers who do not know how to light dark skin because they simply don't have the education or the access to equipment, because it is something. I mean, you know, your production crew, I mean, you would also know that, you know, you have to pick the contrast, color grading software, automatic color grading, for example. Again, which is accessible to the average person, is catered to Eurocentric beauty. So you're automatically going to get filtered. You're going to lighten, you know, the specs are set to lighten you.
Even on iPhone Auto, if you press Auto, it more often than not just makes you lighter. And that's also, I think it's the messaging as well. What are we telling young girls? Like, is the automatic standard lighter? Is the, I don't know, I feel like there's so much to unpack, but I think the most important thing is to make sure that no one continues to feel like this, that these conversations, not just, we don't sit here unpacking like in an arts class, but actually talking about how we can together kind of challenge this notion. And I feel like I sometimes find myself feeling into it. I sometimes feel insecure, even like sometimes I raise my arms, sometimes like, oh, I got a dark underarms, but it's like pigmentation, like it's just us.
Yeah.
And like, we're cute, we don't need to feel bad about it.
Yeah,
like, so ridiculous.
I mean, and I think that's what's important, that these conversations continue to happen, that we raise our young people to be more sort of to accept them, their authenticity, to develop self-worth, so that, you know, they don't fall into that commercialized, that capitalism trap. And I think as a society, what we need to do is also, in a way, if this is what we have created now, you need to battle the monster, right? So that would be, I would be a sort of a promoter of, don't fall for the bullshit that's out there.
Yeah.
I mean, don't fall for the brands that are telling you that you're not good enough if you don't change.
It's as old as written history, though. Look at our Jataka stories, our history, Elara Dutu Gamunu. Like, everything, it's so pervasive, it's everywhere. And, like, no wonder it's hard. No wonder we spend so much time trying to, like, figure it out.
Yeah.